Traditionally, the story of Western classical music is told as one great male genius after another. Across the centuries, many composers have been inspired by female singers to write dazzling roles for women.
But what about works written by a female composer? That's a different matter altogether. I can count on the fingers of one hand the ones that I've performed in.
I'm an opera singer who's studied and performed all over the world. And only now am I seeing female composers taken seriously. Because the truth is that women, despite facing all kinds of challenges, have always composed. They've produced great works, like this one by Florence Price. It's just that time has not been kind or even fair in preserving their legacy. So why is that? From all the female composers over the past millennium, I've picked five exceptional ones who helped shape Western musical history.
Women who had to fight to fulfill their ambitions and overcome the obstacles that society placed in their way.
Through incredible talent.
By the time she was 20 years old, she was a superstar.
And dogged determination.
This was her piano, and she would say occasionally she'd find herself like this, asleep on the keys.
It's a story that will take us from the creative powerhouse of the medieval convent to the beauty and brutality of Florence's Medici court. From conflicted sexual politics in the 19th century to blatant discrimination in the 20th. Each of my composers found fame in her lifetime, but then disappeared into obscurity. Only some have gained recognition again.
All of them have stories that deserve to be told and music that deserves to be heard.
In 1934, at London's Royal Albert Hall, a birthday concert celebrated Dame Ethel Smythe, one of the first women who had her music performed at the proms. Smythe, whose work is largely forgotten now, once wrote, "The whole English attitude towards women in fields of art is ludicrous and uncivilized. How you compose is what matters."
Smythe was a passionate suffragette during the time when women were campaigning for the right to vote. She even wrote the movement's anthem, The March of the Women, a song so well known that at a rally here at the Albert Hall in 1911, the crowd burst into a spontaneous rendition of it.
March, march, sweep you along. White was our banner and hope is waking.
So this is where Ethel Smythe conducted her rousing chorus, March of the Women.
Yes, back in 1911, this hall had been filled with people supporting the suffragette and suffragist movement. She'd written the music. You can hear their voices now. She was handed her baton by Emmeline Pankhurst, no less.
"I feel I must fight for my music," Smythe once said.
At every stage in a young girl's life, there were barriers put in her way. And the really sad thing is, we don't know of the 99% of women who were silenced early on in their careers, who had the talent, had the exceptional ability, but simply did not have access to education, support. And even when they do succeed in writing music, then they don't have access to the spaces for that music to be performed.
The composers who managed to surmount the numerous barriers, how did they manage it?
There's a T-shirt that says something like, you know, well-behaved women rarely make history. So determination, I think, is the key quality of every woman who continued to pursue her compositional career. I think also a kind of sheer love of creation, of making that music.
All that is found in the story of Hildegard, who lived here in the German town of Bingen in the 12th century and revolutionized her era's main musical form, religious song. And her story shows how a composer's work can disappear for centuries before attracting a new audience.
Hildegard is the very first composer in the history of Western music, male or female, who we really know about. And what a composer she was. For me, her music is genuinely spine-tingling and way ahead of its time.
Hildegard's soaring compositions anticipated polyphony, the combination of melodies in a single verse that became the foundation of Western music.
What's even more remarkable is that she achieved all of this in an era when the church stuck rigidly to St. Paul's doctrine that women should remain silent in churches. They weren't even allowed to join in with the singing. They had to mime along.
In a male-dominated society based on the Bible, Eve's role in the fall from grace cast women as seductresses whose voices led men astray. Instead of an arranged marriage, Hildegard was placed in a convent by her parents when she was 8. Ironically, nuns had more musical freedom than most other women.
You put them in a convent, they can sing as much as they like. And my God, there is some fabulous music. They're safe, they're sequestered, and their music can take you to the divine.
Hildegard ended up running the convent, and her own music was inspired by a remarkable series of visions in 1141.
Can you tell us a little bit about these visions?
She says that in my 43rd year, there was coming a very brilliant fiery light out of heaven. And this light was flooding my mind. And then she hears a heavenly voice, and this voice commands, tell and write down what you see and hear.
So contrary to our commonly held beliefs that people are very restricted in the convent life, Hildegard suddenly had an almost divine freedom to compose.
In every aspect, she was creating a own universe.
A visionary.
A visionary universe. She is doing strange things in a monastery. Nuns are standing in the choir. They have open hair. They wear golden crowns. They have silk garments on.
She must have been aware that she was ahead of her time.
Yes, because you can easily hear and detect something, this is Hildegard. Because she has a very, so to say, ecstatic language.
Over the next decade, Hildegard composed 77 musical pieces, sung by her nuns at religious ceremonies. And fortunately, they were collected, along with her other writings, in illuminated manuscripts like this one, dating from around 1150. Until the Middle Ages, music was an oral tradition. It was in monasteries and convents like Hildegard's that scribes first wrote it down.
This is the only surviving volume of Hildegard's collected works that she was directly involved in putting together. It looks like a treasure trove. These are individual sheets of music that were used to sing from in Hildegard's Abbey. You can see here stains on the music, stitches even in the parchment. Quite familiar to people who really get a lot of wear and tear out of their music, like I do. What a piece of history.
Translated from the Latin, Hildegard's language is not what I'd expected from a woman closeted behind convent walls.
It's overflowing with exuberance and even sensual imagery. Greenness in gardens, growth and fire, and purity and womanhood.
This Benedictine abbey near Bingen is still run in Hildegard's name, and the sisters here still sing Hildegard's revolutionary compositions. Back then, the musical rules, laid down by men, of course, stressed simplicity and austerity. But in Hildegard's far more expansive pieces, words and melodies flow and work together. So I've come for a lesson in how to sing one.
It's not so easy.
No, it's not.
I'm looking at what you're reading here, and it looks very different to the music I've grown up reading my whole life. How can you describe what this is?
The most important thing is that you have, in a sort, meditated the text.
Yes.
We have in this music a very near connection between the text and the melody. This connection gives what you have to do with the melody. Also, the accent of the word is important. Caritas.
Caritas.
And not caritas.
Of course.
It's the accent from the Latin word. And then you have the flow from the first accent of this word. And we have to consider here, when you have two notes on the same level, you have to sing both.
You have to
punctuate
them.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's also important for the flow of the melody.
Okay.
Caritas means love,
yes.
And you find in the Bible, God is love, and this is the image of God for Hildegard.
Abundat in omnia.
Yeah. Which this means flowing in everything.
In everything,
in
that's
everything.
Right.
Hildegard created a kind of republic of women within her convent walls, united by a shared musical experience.
We all know the emotional power of singing. And we all know the emotional power of hearing other voices around you and becoming part of a whole. And you were singing music of the beauty at which Hildegard was composing it, then you were part in all senses of something bigger.
Hildegard died in 1179 at the grand old age of 81. Her remains are contained in a gold casket here at the parish church of St. Hildegard. During her lifetime, Hildegard was something of a celebrity in Germany. But over the centuries, two male French monks called Adam of St. Victor and Léonin have been credited as the earliest identifiable composers. The first mention in a reference book of Hildegard's music only came in the late 20th century. Then in 1983, a CD called A Feather on the Breath of God brought her compositions to a much wider audience. Albums of very early music didn't exactly fly off the shelves, and so there was very little expectation for commercial success. In fact, even the sound engineer had said, "Lovely music, shame no one will buy it." But boy, was he wrong. Hildegard's music struck a chord with audiences, and that album sold over 500,000 copies. Nearly 1,000 years since Hildegard composed it, her music has been receiving the attention it deserves. And I think she would have liked some of the surprising ways it's been reinvented. Like this 2012 ambient album, produced by Guy Sigsworth, whose clients include Madonna and Bjork.
I didn't want this to be a kind of hair shirt, difficult, purist classical record that would kind of scare people off. Because to me, Hildegard's music has a kind of generosity, sort of ravishing luxury to it. And so I wanted to make sure that we were true to that.
Rita.
Therefore, I wanted to find colours that you could complement these beautiful rhapsodic melodies. You're not taking liberties with the music, you're discovering the liberties that are in the music. And that's what I was trying to do with Hildegard.
My next composer lived here in the Italian city of Florence in the 17th century. Like Hildegard before her, Francesca Caccini lived in an era where young women's choices were incredibly restricted.
If they don't get put into convents, then they will have to be married because they cannot be respectable and autonomous if they're not. And once they're married, that means becoming a breeding cow for children. And there's no room for them to have any kind of professional engagement in the world.
Yet Francesca Caccini managed to become one of her generation's most successful composers. So how did she do it? Hard work, determination, incredible talent, of course, played their part. But Caccini was born lucky too.
In the 17th century, a beautiful singing voice was much prized in Italian music, with composer Claudio Monteverdi in Venice pioneering the new art form of opera. And since the late 1500s, Italian courts had allowed female servants to become paid singers. Some of them began to compose too. The Florentine court was ruled over by the all-powerful Medici clan. During the Renaissance, the Medicis were generous patrons of the arts, but they governed Florence with an iron fist.
It was full of creativity and full of beauty, but it was equally, I think, full of corruption and brutality. You know, they may look civilized, they may look cultured, but if your daughter-in-law or your brother-in-law causes trouble there, there is a dungeon, there is a prison.
In 1607, 20-year-old Caccini found a place with the Medicis, whose main residence was here at the Pitti Palace. She was basically a servant, but a servant whose job was to sing and compose music.
So here we are in the main palace of the Medicis. So how did their court help the careers of female artists like Caccini?
Well, first of all, we have to remember that Florence at that time was one of the most important, if not the most important city in Italy and perhaps in the world. So this was like being in Hollywood.
How successful was Francesca Caccini as a singer and a composer?
She was probably the first diva in history. She was a very talented girl. She made her grand debut when she was 13 years old. And by the time she was 20 years old, she was a superstar here at court.
So what was working life like day to day for Francesca Caccini?
She was the main teacher in the palace. And also she had to compose music on demand. You know, she was commissioned music with very short notice and something like, hey, Francesca, we need a new piece for next week.
Caccini was incredibly prolific, yet her music is not well known today. To me, her songs feel very modern, soulful, and even bluesy. I wanted to try singing one.
It's first sight reading, but
we try.
Ardo infelice, e quale esor non tento, a chi l'alma distrugge il fuoco mio, ben si legge nel volto il mio tormento e l'affanno del cor narra il desio.
Buona la prima.
Sì.
Caccini, like all women of her era, lived under strict guidelines for virtuous behavior. Her own singing voice, a contemporary Cristoforo Bronzini wrote, had such stunning effects on her listeners that she changed them from what they had been. A great compliment, but hazardous too. Florence's courtesans were notorious for singing that lured men into sin.
So song would be connected with Eve and the temptress.
Perhaps this is why Bronzini was at pains to stress that Caccini was not favored by the gifts of nature. In other words, she wasn't attractive. Because women who had the whole package were just way too threatening.
But Caccini thrived both as a singer and composer of vocal and theatrical works. The Medicis, who owned the rights to her music, even paid for some of them to be published. I've come to Florence's National Central Library to examine an edition of Caccini's songs from 1618, when she was 31.
There are only three of these that survived, and this one I'm holding here is the best preserved of them. The first thing that's so interesting about this is that the biggest thing in the title is the name of the Cardinale di Medici. So you can see immediately Francesca Caccini, you know, had to play by the rules of the game.
But the songs can feel slightly subversive, like the piece I sang earlier.
This is a lament that talks about a burning desire.
Pensi legge nel volto il mio tormento.
There's a B natural.
Pensi legge nel volto.
Now this note, this B natural, is not a part of this key. To me, sort of expresses like a spur of color, a spur of desire. And in fact, the text that she chose to make this note appear on is, you can well see in my face my torment. And, you know, I look at this text and we've got a woman here who is constrained by the rules of court life. The phrase starts to expand as well to reflect this desire to reach out. But of course, she has to return back to her key, to her constraints.
In 1621, the death of Grand Duke Cosimo II allowed Caccini to write what is said to be the first surviving opera by a woman. Cosimo's son was only 11, and until he came of age, his mother, the formidable Maria Magdalena, ruled the Medici court as regent.
You did get, occasionally, very powerful women. We had Queen Elizabeth I in England. In fact, at this time, the Florentine court was entirely run by women. And a lot of the opera really is justifying the fact that women can rule.
Of course, this was done while being suitably pious and virtuous. Though other operas written at the time featured remarkable women, 36-year-old Caccini's stands out for its celebration of female strength. Melissa, a good sorceress, rescues Ruggero, a knight, from the clutches of an evil sorceress.
The real superhero of this story is Melissa. And Melissa may well have been based on the character of the Archduchess herself, Maria Magdalena.
The premiere of The Liberation of Ruggero took place here at Magdalena's Villa Poggio Imperiale.
Imagine the scene. It's February 3rd, 1625, the day of the villa's grand opening. And all the great and the good Florentine society are arriving in their carriages up a beautiful, wide avenue. The high point of the celebrations is the premiere of Caccini's proto-opera. It took place not inside, but in a loggia, an outside covered gallery.
It's a major piece of music. It's not just a little interesting piece because it's by a woman.
In the four centuries since, performances of Caccini's opera have been rare. This version, set in Edwardian Brighton, is one of the first times it's been staged in Britain.
She was brought up singing concerted music for female voices. That's the real characteristic of this opera that makes it glorious. The whole moral of this story at the end, which is the final chorus, really, is that it's all right. Women can rule, but men can still be men, and women can still be women. And I have heard rumours of other performances that might be mounted. So if we started something like that, then I'm totally thrilled.
Not long after Caccini's death around 1641, the Age of Enlightenment began in Europe. You might have thought this championing of reason and liberty over dogma and tradition would help transform the lives of women like my next composer, Clara Schumann. But instead, their very ability to be creative was questioned.
The 18th century philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau had proclaimed, "Women in general possess no artistic sensibility nor genius. Their creations are as cold and pretty as women. They have an abundance of spirit but lack soul." In Clara Schumann's time, there were plenty of men and women who still believed that.
Clara was born Clara Wieck here in Leipzig in 1819. Piano works by German composers like Johann Sebastian Bach and Ludwig van Beethoven were all the rage, and Clara, like many middle and upper class girls, learned to play the piano. Most just played for family and friends at home. But Clara was a prodigy, and her father Friedrich was what today we might call a tiger dad. Mozart's piano concerts as a child half a century before had left the public hungry for more, even if the performer was a girl. There was good money to be made too, as long as the stage image was suitably demure.
She needed to appear slightly melancholy, the girl with the sad eyes. A certain innocence tying in with that. And it was cultivated really ruthlessly by the family, whereas behind the scenes, Clara was actually quite feisty.
But women of this era were expected to keep feistiness under wraps.
In the 19th century, the piano was one of the very few instruments considered acceptable for a woman to play. And the reasoning for this has to do with the male perception of the female body. To start with, I'm sitting down, so this would preserve my modesty, apparently. Also, there are no rapid, unladylike movements. Unlike the violin, which was considered very unsuitable, all that head-bending and rapid arm movements, not to mention the frisson from the feminine-like curves of the instrument itself. And the cello? Don't even go there.
Clara gave her first solo concert aged 11, and by her mid-teens, she'd become one of Europe's great concert pianists. Mostly she performed other people's work, but the custom was that pianists would also play some of their own. And composing was often a joy for Clara, who once wrote, "There's nothing that surpasses the joy of creation."
Clara's father encouraged her to compose. It might not have been for the best of reasons, but there were good, hard-headed commercial reasons. He could put his daughter up there as not only the virtuosa of her generation, but as somebody who could just write a piano concerto at 15.
For decades, pianist Lucy Parham has championed Clara's piano works, including that precocious piano concerto.
It starts like that, and the piano has this beautiful, long solo, which was really unusual at that time.
It's so lyrical, but it's got quite a lot of depth.
I imagine her as being a woman or a child at that point who was kept very much at home, you know, under the tutelage of her father. So really, music was the only way she could let out all these feelings. It's very beautiful. But then we've had the Yanni, and then she goes into, she has all these flying tense double thirds, and she's like, look what I can do. I'm really clever.
Clara draws on the passionate, tempestuous music of 19th century Romanticism. This was rather radical, as women were supposed to compose gentle, undemanding pieces.
And that's the opening.
Gosh. But there was a critic who said that if the name of the composer were not in the title, one would never have known it was written by a woman.
And they were right, because it's so full of passion and strength. She was a strong woman.
Clara's father worried what would happen to her composing when she married. At the time, a wife's only priority was supposed to be her husband and children. And Friedrich wasn't happy when Clara fell for one of his own students, Robert Schumann. Robert would become one of the 19th century's greatest composers. And his relationship with Clara is one of music's great love affairs, encoded in their compositions, like this nocturne by Clara.
This piece is really significant because it has a little motif in it that pervaded their whole relationship. And it starts like this. So this five note, which is the five letters of her name for Clara, this theme was used by Robert in some of his most famous compositions. I mean, the fantasy starts like... And even the notes of the beginning, these are the five notes. So they would send each other compositions, and this theme meant that they were thinking of one another. It was like saying, I love you, but it was in music.
It's so romantic.
It's so romantic.
And Robert Schumann described this as like the buds before the wings of colour are exploded into open splendour.
And that would have meant so much to her because she really lacked confidence, and when he said something beautiful about her compositions, it gave her confidence to compose more.
But progressive as he was, Robert was also a creature of his time. Men stand higher than women, he wrote.
Robert, in the end, for all his grand words about compositional collaboration, about how they were both going to develop their art together, in the end, he wanted his tea on the table.
This is a reproduction of a book that Robert gave to Clara as a Christmas present in 1839, the year before they married. His initials are here, R.S. He had a special cover made and embossed with gold lettering saying, Meine Hausfrau gewidmet, which means dedicated to my housewife. This is a cookbook. Clara herself had written to Robert earlier in the year, I will do everything possible to set myself up so well that you're at peace. But she'd also written, Must I bury my art now? Love is all very beautiful, but
but. After marriage, the couple lived in an apartment in this building here. Clara refused to give up her concerts, but she seemed to accept that her composing was not as important as his. At public recitals, Clara performed new works by Robert. Her own were only performed at home. Add children into the mix, and Robert's developing mental illness, and it's surprising she wrote music at all. Yet, in 1846, Clara composed a masterpiece, this piano trio.
The story of this piano trio is even more poignant when you consider what Clara was dealing with at the time.
Not only did she have four young children, but she was pregnant with a fifth, which then miscarried.
And as if that wasn't enough, Robert also had a mental collapse during the same time. Despite all of this, Clara still found great satisfaction in writing her trio. She said, "There is nothing better than composing something oneself, then hearing it played." But when Robert wrote his own piano trio shortly after, all of her self-doubt crept back in. Of course, her piece, she said, remains the work of a woman.
It's only in the 21st century that interest has really revived in the 50 or so piano works Clara Schumann left behind. After Robert's death, Clara spent the next 40 years focused on his legacy rather than her own. She stopped composing completely.
The fact that she chose performance over composition, I think, speaks to that powerful idea that women are allowed on stage to perform other people's works. They are interpreters, they are muses.
She once wrote, "A woman must not desire to compose. There has never yet been one able to do it. Should I expect to be the one?" It feels like a great loss for Clara personally, and for all of us who missed out on more works from this incredibly talented woman.
What could Clara Schumann have achieved today?
I think she would have achieved superstardom. She would probably have had her pieces played at the proms, and she would have, you know, been a real composer pianist in the tradition of all the great composer pianists.
By the 1930s, the situation of women in Western music was improving. Female musicians in Britain and America now played in full-size symphony orchestras. But performances of symphonies by female composers remained rare. American composer Florence Price was especially aware of the obstacle she faced with this piece, her Symphony No. 1. "I have two handicaps," she once wrote, "those of sex and race. I'm a woman, and I have Negro blood in my veins."
But it was performed by the Chicago Symphony Orchestra in 1933. The premiere was a genuinely historic event, the first performance by a major orchestra of a symphony by an African-American woman. And the reception was rapturous. One critic wrote that it was a faultless work, worthy of a place in the regular repertoire. So how did Price pull this off?
Price's story and music are grounded here in America's Deep South. She was born in 1887 in Arkansas. Society remained segregated. Slavery had only been abolished 20 years earlier. Price's family was middle class, but like these African-American children, she grew up immersed in gospel songs and spirituals. Price studied music at college and began to create a unique musical style, mixing romanticism with gospel. And in 1912, she married and started a family. But there was still racial violence by mobs and groups like the Ku Klux Klan.
After a brutal lynching in Arkansas in 1927, the family moved to Chicago.
Florence Price's story isn't one of those fairy tales where she moves to the big city and everything works out fine. In 1931, she made a difficult decision to divorce her husband who'd become abusive, and she suddenly found herself raising two children on her own. So she went out to work, making money by playing the organ to accompany silent movie screenings and composing radio jingles. And somehow, she still carved out the time to write her own compositions.
She wrote orchestral and chamber works, violin and piano concertos. And arrangements of traditional spirituals, one of which was sung in 1939 at a momentous concert in Washington, D.C.
The nation's most impressive Easter demonstration. 75,000 mass before Lincoln Memorial to hear Marian Anderson, colored contralto, make her capital debut at the Great Emancipator Shrine.
Washington's concert hall refused to let a non-white artist perform inside. Eleanor Roosevelt, the First Lady, was furious, and the concert was moved outdoors. This historic set closed with Price's arrangement of My Soul's Been Anchored in the Lord.
In the Lord, in the Lord, my soul's been anchored in the Lord. In the Lord, in the Lord, my soul's been anchored in the Lord.
Of course, singing styles have changed since the 1930s. So how should a contemporary classically trained singer like me approach My Soul's Been Anchored in the Lord?
In the Lord.
I went to meet Misha Paris, whose background is in gospel music.
The first thing I'm thinking about is I have to evoke enough emotion so that the audience are totally taken by the message and think about how each lyric is going to pierce the person listening.
You know, this first phrase, it's a short phrase, in the Lord. So how do you start to sing it?
You're gonna go, in the Lord. And you hear the church, because that's why the church is so brilliant, because that acoustic.
In the Lord, in the Lord.
And give it a bit of welly. You see what happens, you start to feel something.
Should we sing it together?
Yeah.
Okay, ready?
In the Lord.
Nice. Good, right?
It felt good.
Feels good, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, when we were singing it together, it felt really reflective, like it could be something that is both happy and melancholy at the same time.
Yeah. If you remember, this comes from slavery. And in those times of slavery, it was the spiritual songs that got them through. When they were on those cotton fields, they were trying to keep motivated.
Keep going.
Keep going. And that's where gospel comes from. Gospel comes from that time of that's all they had.
In the Lord, in the Lord, my soul's been anchored in the Lord.
That was dope. Am I allowed to say that?
I can't believe it.
That was gorgeous.
By the early 1950s, Price's work was performed across the USA and here in London too. The Royal Albert Hall, founded by Queen Victoria to promote the arts, was now bringing music to the masses via the proms. And in 1950, Marian Anderson also performed here, as I discovered in the archives.
And she does an amazing program with many of the great composers, Bach, Brahms, Donizetti, Britten. And at the very end, she saved for last, "My soul's been anchored in the Lord."
After Price's death in 1953, her sweeping melodies fell out of favor, replaced by the harder-edged music of modernism.
But recently, interest in her has rekindled, especially since 2009, when dozens of scores were found in an abandoned house in Illinois that Price used as a summer home. They included two lost violin concertos and an unheard fourth symphony. Dr. Shirley Thompson, a British composer, selected one of these newly found works to be performed and recorded for the very first time. The piece she picked is Price's Concert Overture No. 2.
The power is in this depth of feeling, which is not, I don't think it's an easy thing to achieve, but I think she just has that timing that can make it happen.
In the musical style that Price pioneered, this concerto weaves together the themes from three spirituals, including Let My People Go.
I love the way that she uses harmonic progression. I love her confidence in that journey. She doesn't rush there, she just takes her time. I think her pacing is perfect. I think it adds this soul to classical music and the repertoire. I think it brings this majesty to and dignity to what had happened in the cotton fields, to what those people, my forefathers, suffered.
For conductor Jane Glover, it's an opportunity to champion the work of a forgotten composer who deserves a wider audience.
It's thrilling to play it, knowing that it's been sitting in a box in a private house on the south side of Chicago for decades, and here we are doing it. The only thing that matters is quality. I think it certainly deserves a place in programs from now on.
In early 20th century Britain, my last composer, Elizabeth Maconchy, blazed a trail through institutional sexism and the familiar challenges of family life. By the time Maconchy moved to London from Ireland in 1923, suffragette protests had helped many British women gain the vote. But much of the musical establishment still refused to take women seriously. Maconchy arrived at the Royal College of Music at a time when many of the tutors, like the composer Ralph Vaughan Williams, were promoting a British pastoral school of music. But Maconchy preferred cutting-edge continental composers like Bella Bartok.
Bartok was a big influencer for her?
I think so, yes. And most of the tutors, of the professors there, were not really involved in new music, so they would kind of go like this if she played a chord, and instead of being that, was that. But that's Bartok. Yes. It's not a wrong note.
And ingrained sexism reared its ugly head when Maconchy applied for the prestigious Mendelssohn Scholarship.
Head of the college came up to me and congratulated me on getting the scholarship. And I said, but I didn't get it. You gave it to David Emmons. And he said, oh, they must have changed it after I'd left. Anyway, if we'd given it to you, you'd have only got married and never written another note. Well, I did get married, but I did continue to write many notes.
Maconchy's husband, William Lefanu, was a great supporter of his wife's composing. And in 1930, some of Maconchy's many notes led to sudden success when this piece, The Land, was accepted at the prompts.
Both Vaughan Williams and Holst were there at the proms, and Holst went up to my father and said, keep her at it, keep her at it. He did know that he didn't need to keep her at it because my mother was absolutely so strong in her vocation as a composer, nothing would make her swerve from it.
Maconchy was just 23 when The Land was performed. Girl composer triumphs, wrote one newspaper. That kind of attitude meant it took Maconchy nearly a decade to find a publishing deal.
One found that there was a great prejudice against girls. Publishers, particularly, or concert promoters, they only thought of them as able to write little things like piano pieces and songs, not as serious composers. And as for getting performances, there was no way.
So, in 1931, a remarkable group of women got together and set up their own London showcase for new composers, including works by Maconchy.
This building behind me used to be the Mercury Theatre where these groundbreaking performances took place. But Maconchy's modernist-influenced music wasn't entirely to the taste of the critics.
Some couldn't get past the fact that, oh my goodness, there are women composers composing pieces of, and I quote, almost aggressive virility. And the one lone man was producing somewhat effeminate little songs. That's what you get when you do a concert based on women's music.
As modernist music became more mainstream in the 1940s and 50s, Maconchy's career went from strength to strength.
These are programs for premieres of Maconchy's works at Royal Albert Hall, the earliest in 1942. Maconchy in a lineup with Mendelssohn, Brahms, Dvorak, and Tchaikovsky. It's a pretty good lineup. Maconchy's favorite musical form was the string quartet. She wrote 13. She said the thrill of composing them was like combining the intuition and skill of a poet with the excitement of driving a four-horse carriage.
In the early 1940s, Britain had endured the traumas of German bombing during the Blitz. And this unsettling piece, Maconchy's String Quartet No. 4, struck a chord. Along with Benjamin Britten's Symphony No. 1, Maconchy's continued composing was seen as a sign of British pluck and creativity in the face of adversity.
Her fourth quartet was recorded by the BBC, broadcast across Europe. It was a symbol that the show would go on. And people loved its intensity, its drive, its seriousness. And for a moment, they even forgot that it was a woman who composed it because there were greater things at stake.
Maconchy's personal favourite, the fifth quartet, followed in 1948. It's played here by students from the Royal College of Music. The group call themselves the Maconchy Quartet.
Nicola, the fifth string quartet was composed while both you and your sister were ill.
Yes, I think it's remarkable. My sister had appendicitis. She was in Dublin. My parents were in Ireland, and then they had to come back to England because I was in Great Ormond Street because I had had an adverse reaction to a vaccination. So somehow, despite this, my mother found the space, even though it was such a worrying time, to write this wonderful quartet.
Like Clara Schumann, Maconchy had to manage the competing demands of motherhood and creativity. She did so with her usual grit and determination.
I can remember her playing the piano when I'd gone to bed and my sister had gone to bed and we'd hear the piano and it sounds rather romantic, but it wasn't really. It was because it was the only time in the day she had to compose.
And in a similar way to Schumann, Maconchy wrestled with self-doubt and writer's block.
She was a very severe self-critic. She used to write here at this piano, and she'd have the manuscript paper up here, and then she'd throw it on the floor.
I've always scrapped a great deal and used a great deal of manuscript paper, because I think you either write Mozart and Schubert way, with the music just running down your pen onto the paper, or the Beethoven way, which is the hard way, with awful heart searchings and scrappings and so on, and that's really the way I write.
In 1952, one of these painfully delivered pieces, Proud Thames, won a competition to be London's coronation overture.
Against all the odds, Maconchy was becoming a national treasure. She went on to be appointed chair of the Composers Guild of Great Britain and was even made a dame of the British Empire. And yet, since McConkie's death, she's become known as one of our finest lost composers. Her works have become much harder to find in the repertoire than those of her male contemporaries, like Vaughan Williams or Britten.
Is it that she writes this quite dense, cerebral music? Then again, other people wrote music like that. They just happen to be men, and we still hear their music. I don't like to accept the depressing truth that it simply has to be the fact that she was a woman working in a world that was, and to some extent still remains, ruled by a set of values or a set of ideas about what makes a great composer. And one of those things is to be born a man.
So how far have we actually come in the new millennium? And how much is still left to do? In 2013, Maren Alsop became the first woman to conduct the last night of the proms.
I'm incredibly honored and proud to have this title, but I have to say I'm still quite shocked that it can be 2013 and there can be firsts for women.
Maren, what is it like to be a woman in classical music today?
Well, I think it's a much more positive outlook. And I think it's a moment of optimism and hope, but also it's a moment where we can't let our guard down. We have to continue to be vigilant about creating opportunities.
Particularly for female composers.
Yeah.
Do you find the avenues opening up for them?
I think female composers would say that there's certainly more opportunity now than there was. And as a composer, you have to try things on the orchestra. And without those opportunities, really, I don't think greatness can really exist.
And how important is it for the next generation of female composers and conductors to know about the women who came before them and know these histories?
This is critical. Having a sense of history behind you, you know, and in front of you, so that you feel supported is essential to feeling entitled. Women need to know these stories. They need to celebrate these stories.
Yet in 2016, there were as many performances of Shostakovich's string quartets in just 1 week as there had been of McConkie's in the previous 5 years. And the truth is, the female composers we've looked at represent only a tiny sample of an estimated 6,000 whose work has been forgotten. There's still a long way to go.